Welcome to FBI, Holly.
AKA Flume, arguably the biggest artist.
ダンスミュージック界の新たな才能、Flume.
And today joined by Harley, known to the world, Flume.
That started it all.
That dude just like churns tunes out.
He knows exactly what he wants, and there's no bullshit.
I think he's taken off because he deserves it.
I think the reason Flume's different is that Holly's really interested in songwriting as much as he is experimenting.
He's taking, you know, these musical instincts and then engaging with these programs. What he does is so fluid and natural sounding.
He's formulated a sound that is, you know, captivating an entire country. That's rare.
For me, the most important thing about music is it sounding new and exciting. And like, I want to hear music that I have never heard before.
You are listening to today's Hottest 100, counting down your favorite songs of 2016. Number one, Flume!
Did you ever think writing that song that it would make Hottest 100 number one?
Oh my God, no. Definitely not.
The ARIA Award goes to Flume!
Flume has won 8 ARIAs, 4 of them tonight.
How are you feeling?
Over the moon. I'm really, really surprised.
I want the top. All my people right there in the back of the spot. I need the top. If you know me, you don't know me, stop.
When I was probably about 8 years old, I was shopping in the supermarket with my dad, and there was a special promotion going on with this cereal. Inside the box, they had a music-making software. We got it, took it home, installed the little program onto the computer. I remember being completely bewildered and amazed. You know, I'd listened to music all my life, and I'd never really thought about there's layers to this. And I could see the layers, I could see the synthesizers, I could see the guitars, I could see the vocals, and it just kind of, yeah, it amazed me. I wanted to explore it further, and I wanted to know more.
Really, all his life he's been really into music. Oh, he would have only been about 2, I guess. He was still in the car seat. One of my favourite tracks, it was Morrison's Moondance, came on. I think there was about 3 notes played, and Harley piped up and said, "Dad, that's your favourite piece of music." And it's like, even then I thought, how do you know that?
Got like a whole bunch of different things going on, but I'll kind of play this like a piano.
And we bought him software and computers, and he always knew what he wanted to do.
I think I was working at a news agency in the Northern Beaches. I had all these demos on my computer. They were just some silly ideas. Well, that's what I thought of them at the time. Anyways, Future Classic were running this competition, and my friend, he told me about it. He was like, "Yeah, you should send in those weird Flume things that you've got." And I thought, "Yeah, cool. What have I got to lose, you know?" So I sent them in, and Nathan and Chad got back to me a couple of weeks later, and they're like, "Yeah, you got runner up."
We had roughly 500 artists submit work. I remember starring Flume thing, coming back to that. It sounded naive and fun and different. We pulled into the back road. We got in touch with Harley and said, come in. He rocked up in like Northern Beaches surfing gear. I think he had thongs on.
I think I had thongs on.
And you were just like, yeah, whatever, super tan, and just like, you know, like, looked like you'd been like boogie boarding that afternoon.
I probably had.
I think it was September 2011, I was invited over to do a conference called Big Sound in Brisbane. We just sort of saw this big queue outside a club and we're like, this looks, you know, really busy. We should go for this. Let's give this a shot. We got inside eventually and it was actually Flume playing. And the show was just amazing. Like, it was totally transportive. And at that point, I was like, I wonder if he's got a record company in the UK and Europe. And then the next day, I met Nathan from Future Classic and begged him over many drinks to let us sign Flume. And that's kind of how it started.
I was able to go over there and see Flume play to 5,000 people at, I believe it was Horton. You know, it was such a defining moment to sort of carry back to America.
In 2012, I was actually Harley's booking agent. He'd been doing shows around Australia at the time, but nothing more than like 300 or 400 people in like a basement club. I'd gotten him booked at Splendor in the Grass, which is like a very big deal festival in Australia. That show, it started with probably like maybe a third or a half full tent, and by the end of it, he'd packed the whole thing out, 6,000 people. The energy was nuts. The bookers of the festival, lots of people were sort of taking notice. I think for the team, it was a moment where it was like, okay, this is like much bigger than anything we've done at this point. There's like an audience which is tuning into this. They're ready to go. It sort of told us like, okay, this thing has legs. We need to get ready and we need to figure out how we're actually gonna work this thing and take it to another level.
Big believer that you have to be candid with artists. The start, you have people in your ear saying, these guys don't know what they're doing. I know what I'm doing. Fuck them. Come with me,
yeah,
or whatever.
Yeah, definitely.
And so Harley was asking a lot of questions, as any artist should.
We're both really bad at lying, so like we'll just be blatantly honest with each other, which is what you need.
We had one time where we were just like, Chad and I kind of got together and we're just like, Harley, you can't be a dick, basically.
I was basically like, it was all new to me. I thought I was like the cool, I thought I was the hot shit. You know, like I had fans, I was 20, I was getting drunk in the club, I was being an idiot.
Nathan and Chad approached me. They said they had this young 19-year-old called Harley. He has grown up so much in the few years that I've known him, and I'm so proud of him. I remember the first time I met him and he was wearing sunglasses inside, which is my absolute pet hate. I was like, Harley, we're gonna work together, you're gonna have to take your sunnies off inside.
It's complicated, isn't it?
There's some
management.
There's some complicated stuff, yeah. I mean, every relationship's really different and it takes a while to get to know each other.
He's always calling me up, like late at night, being like, hey, I've got this idea. Why don't we like do this and then we'll do this song and then link it with this thing and then make this whole big, and he's got these like big picture ideas, which is really cool.
That's the bit that
like,
I love.
Yeah, you get so excited about that. The strategy.
It's like the strategy is my thing. It's like I absolutely love the way music's gonna be presented into the world.
Infinity Prism Tour, which Chet Faker was a support on that. Harley hit us up, Nick hit his manager Everett up, and like, we need to get in a room and make some music right now.
Nick's strengths are my weaknesses and vice versa. So we've got like a full-on writing procedure down.
Harley always comes to it with like a concept, like, okay, let's do a song where there's no drums in the chorus, or, you know, like this, which sounds like such like a simple idea, but it can make it so much easier when you have a direction like that than like, I'm gonna make a song.
From there on, it's basically, you know, 50-50, we'll just sit down together and work out the structure and how the rest of the track comes about. So that's a little process.
We actually did this song at 301 in the big room, I remember writing it, and I just sat down at the piano and figured out the chords, because he didn't know what they were. And he came over to me and he's like, wow, that's so cool that you can, like, play. I was like, yeah, it's really cool that you can do the blip blip stuff that I can't do.
Yeah, and I kind of try and...
So most of the time when I'm collaborating, it's with another artist who has their own career. So we'll get, you know, a day or two in the studio together. And we may have met. Most of the time we haven't met. So it's like this, cool, you got to meet each other really quickly and like get to know each other fast and then go and create art together.
That right there is brand new stuff from Flume. This track is called Some Minds.
So tell us how you guys met for the first time.
Yeah, we got paired up. I think our managers were kind of chatting and they said that like you were keen, and I was like, oh my God, Andrew from Mike Snow.
Oh, yeah. He's winding me up now.
I was like, holy crap, let's do it. And we ended up getting into a studio and for like one day and just did this thing, and it just worked.
I heard the opportunity to do something that sounded very fresh, and I really liked the way his tracks all sound really fresh.
I played him a few bits and pieces that I've been working on, and I put it on loop for like 45 minutes, and he just sat there. You just sat there on your phone and you were just like humming into it, and then just busted out that chorus hook, and yeah, the rest is history.
He thought I was playing song pop.
Give it up for Andrew Wyatt from Mike Snow.